Welcome to Harty's One2One. My guest this week is cartoonist and caricaturist Bob Bond. Good afternoon, Bob.
Good afternoon, Ian.
Now, we're going to talk about your book very shortly. Very, very special book, especially with Euro 2020 just about to start. But I want to find out about Bob Bond because, you know, there's a lot of people watching this will be going, oh, yeah, that, so, right. Born in Lancashire at the start of the Second World War, you were a keen cartoonist from a very early age, and you were a big part of all of our childhoods. Can you elaborate on this? Because you worked in all our comics. You did lots of illustrations for our comics.
Yes, I did. I worked for Hotspur, Wizard, Roy of the Rovers, Tiger, Lion, quite a lot of those comics. But I didn't want to draw footballers, Ian. I started off very much wanting to do westerns, you know, cowboys and,
oh, right,
and sheriffs and tin badges, you know, and
yeah,
that was what I wanted to do. But I was pushed into football in the early 60s, I suppose. We knew that there was a World Cup coming in England, and the editor rang me up. He said, can you draw footballers? Well, I would have said yes to anything.
Yeah.
If he'd said, can you draw ballet dancers, I would have said yes. But football, I'd always loved football.
Mm.
And I'd come from a football family. My dad and my uncle, very keen football fans. And so I said, yes. So my first drawings were of footballers. They were potted biographies of people like Bobby Moore, Jimmy Greaves, Bobby Charlton, and people like that. And I was cubbyholed, I was pigeonholed as a football artist, and they never sent me any other stories. So, just football.
Going back to your Western things, were there comics back in the 50s and 60s?
Oh, yes, Kit Carson and Tex Ritter and...
Oh, what, so you used to do all that?
No, I didn't.
That's what you wanted to do. Oh, right.
My horses were convincing enough, I guess. So it was football.
Let's talk about this book now. So this is Bob Bond, The Home of English Football, 100 Years of Wembley Stadium in Cartoons and Caricatures. What made you think about this? How did this come about then, Bob?
I guess it was a combined thing. I was approached by the publishers, Pitch Publishing,
Pitch,
here in Worthing, and they said, we've got an anniversary coming up, 100 years of Wembley Stadium. What have you got on Wembley Stadium? So this was last year, and we were in the lockdown, and it was something for me to do. So I just looked in my archives and dug out all the cartoons that I'd ever done of Wembley, and Pitch have put them together in this beautiful book, I think. And what I gave them was a sow's ear, and they've made a silk purse.
I don't think you gave them a sow's ear. There's certain games that I want to touch on. So we'll start with the opening of the stadium, which was the Horse Cup Final. Was it 19...
White Horse Cup Final.
1923.
Yes, 1923. That was the first game.
Bolton Wanderers versus... Well, now, is that your part of Lancashire, Bob, listening to your...
Not quite.
So who are your team then?
My team are Preston.
Preston North End.
Yes.
Tom Finney, the Preston plumber.
Tom Finney, yes. But I was brought up in that part of Lancashire where I could go and watch Tom Finney one Saturday and go and watch Stanley Matthews at Blackpool the following Saturday. So I didn't know how lucky I was to watch the two best players in the world at that time. On alternate Saturdays.
Halcyon days.
The golden age of football, yeah.
So let's start with this. So this is a great drawing here. Bolton 2, West Ham 0. Just talk us through this one.
I think the thing that everyone remembers was that it was a White Horse Final. They'd estimated that about 100,000 people would come to the match. because it was a new stadium. It was the temple of English football, and in fact, 200,000 people turned up, and nobody really knows how many got in, but far more than 100,000, and they encroached the pitch, and the policeman on the white horse had to clear the pitch so the game could go underway. The crowd formed a touchline, more or less. Yes. You know, there were players who actually played a wall pass off the crowd.
And funnily enough, it was the last play at the Gate FA Cup final.
Yes, after that.
After that, it was ticket only. And the other thing going on, which we spoke about, was this. Can you just talk us through this radio times for the Cup final commentary? I know it was a little bit after the first.
They were doing the radio commentary, and the Radio Times thought it would be helpful if the listeners knew which part of the pitch the play was going on. So they divided the pitch up into 8 squares, and as the commentator was telling of the action, someone at the back would be saying 2, 4, 7, and so you'd know exactly where it was, because the listener had this grid in front of him.
But when it went back to the goalkeeper,
it was back to square one.
And that's where that comes from.
Origin of that saying, yes.
Great. Let's move on to the next one. So next up, Bob, a game that you must have enjoyed especially, Queen's Coronation Year 1953. Bolton playing Blackpool.
Yes, it was a great year.
They called it the Matthews Cup Final. Bolton lost. It was Blackpool 4, Bolton 3.
Yes, I was about 13 at the time.
Did you watch it on television?
I watched it on television. My mum and dad had bought a television for the coronation, which was going to happen a few weeks later, the Queen's coronation. And it was an eventful year. I mean, Gordon Richards won the Derby for the one and only time, and Everest was conquered, and Stanley Matthews won his winner's medal. Now, he'd been to 2 finals before and come away beaten, and everyone thought that this was his last opportunity to get a winner's medal, and it actually happened, although Blackpool were 3-1 down with just a few minutes left of the match. They managed to scramble a goal, and then Mortensen hit this wonderful free kick to make it 3-3, and everyone said, well, you know, there's a minute left, but we all knew that minute was long enough for dear old Stanley to create the winning goal for Bill Perry. So that was an amazing final. Amazing final, yes.
The man who's really fighting for his cup medal, could he score the winning goal now, himself? He's there! Kerry! What a final!
In the same year, we had the day English football died, though.
We did,
with
yes.
England 3, Hungary 6.
Yes.
And what can you... Well, I was remember from this game, was that on the television as well? Did you watch that on the television?
I didn't, because it was a Wednesday afternoon and we were at school. We didn't bug off school just to watch football. That wouldn't have been allowed. But I remember coming home that day, and we're walking towards the train, and we asked the porter on the station what was the score, and he said 6-3. And we thought, well, that's right, that's about right, England 6, Hungary 3. But of course it turned out to be the opposite, it was the other way round. They taught England a lesson that day. They played magical football that we'd never ever seen before. It was men from another planet almost, and Puskas and Kocsis and Botsic, they were amazing players. I saw the rerun of the match that evening, and I think Hungary could have scored even more. They declared it 6, really. they got 6 in the first hour, and then they just played around with the ball afterwards, yeah, and sat back. But that taught us a lesson. We thought we were the best in the world, and we knew after that that we weren't.
So we're going to move on to a very famous year, 1966, for English football. But before we talk about that game in July of 1966, we'll talk about the FA Cup final, which was Sheffield Wednesday against Everton. What can you tell us about that one? This great illustration that you've come up with.
Again, I can only tell you that Wednesday appeared to be winning the game very easily. They were two goals ahead. They had Ron Springett in goal, who was England's goalkeeper, and Everton really had been pretty powerless, really. They hadn't been able to shoot their way out of a paper bag. And then suddenly, this unknown Cornishman, Mike Trebilco, scored twice within a few minutes and completely turned the game around.
Mike Trebilco beats Springett with a fine shot. Again, it was the 21-year-old Trebilco who scored to make it 2-2.
And Everton went on to win. Derek Temple scored the winning goal.
Derek Temple had a great chance and made no mistake.
The funniest event, and I think I show the picture there of the man running onto the pitch,
yeah,
and losing, yeah, his trousers.
Yeah. Losing his jacket and everything, yes.
And jacket, yeah.
I don't think he did that again, did he? He only did it once.
But it was a wonderful final. It was.
Now, you've got this amazing caricatures of all the England games. So we start with Uruguay, Mexico, France, and then a game, and you've gone for a double page spread here, so you've really pushed the boat out here, Bob.
That was only at the behest of the people who wanted it for the magazine.
The famous quarter-final.
The famous quarter-final.
England won, Argentina 0, and I saw George Cohen many years ago doing an after dinner, and he had swapped his shirt with an Argentinian, and Ramsay made him give it back. He just wouldn't let them swap shirts.
Ramsay called them animals, didn't he?
Yeah.
And yes, there's a famous picture of him trying to stop George from swapping his shirt.
Absolutely.
But Ratin was the boy, wasn't he?
Yeah, Ratin was the captain, Antonio Ratin. And he got sent off, but he refused to walk at first, didn't he?
He did refuse to walk.
I think he was waiting for VAR.
The referee. I mean, he really struggled to keep things under control. And finally, he had enough, and he showed. Well, I'm not sure there were red cards, but he pointed off.
Off,
you know, and he had to be helped off, I think. You know, he didn't want to go, obviously.
And unfortunately, the next time we played them in the World Cup was 1986, was the hand of God. Diego Maradona, so they paid...
That's not in the book.
No, because it wasn't with me, but they paid us back in spades.
They did.
So, and then moving on to, obviously, the most... Another double-played spread, of course... And the most famous game. Where did you watch the World Cup final?
Well, I was playing cricket, would you believe, that afternoon. The cricket matches were not postponed, they were not cancelled. So we had to go out on the cricket field. And I was batting most of the afternoon. And people were calling out the score from the boundary. 2-1, 2-2. You know, and so I didn't watch the match until that evening, but we heard all the goals going in extra time, and the controversial one that Jeff scored.
Jeff Hurst, cool and collected, had the ball in the net. No goal, protested the Germans.
So all these years later, Bob, come on, it's just you and me.
Well, I've drawn it there.
Do you think it went in?
I've actually shown you how it went in.
Yeah. Oh, well, then,
so anyone who gets the book can see.
So that's cleared it up. By the
cleared
book.
It up completely.
Yeah, we're done then. That's great. Oh, there. This is another one. A couple of years later, and as a Lancastrian, even though it's called Greater Manchester now, it must have been a great night for you when Manchester United were the first English team to win the European Cup.
Yes, certainly saw that one on television, and that was a great evening. I think the turning point was a save by Alex Stepney
from Eusebio.
Yes, you remember that.
I don't remember it because I was only four, but I have.
You read about it?
No, I have seen it, and yeah. It was
that
was at the end of normal time when it was 1-1.
The score was 1-1.
Yeah.
And time running out. Stepney was a wonder goalkeeper to stop that rocket from the big cannon boot of Eusebio, and the great Portuguese star sportingly acknowledged it.
Yes, it was an extra time that George Best scored his wonderful goal.
Mm. Best. He simply walked the ball into the net. What a goal! United in the lead.
And Bobby got another one, and Brian Kidd scored on his 19th birthday, and it all turned out wonderfully for Matt Busby, because he promised that United were going to win the Cup, the European Cup. He promised this years and years before, and it finally happened. So that was a great evening, yeah.
And now, sadly, we're going to move on to now not such a great evening for England, but again, something that you've captured was England 1, Poland 1 in 1973, in October 73. So England go out of the World Cup.
They do, yes. They had to beat Poland, and Brian Clough was then a pundit. He turned from management to punditry.
Well, he'd actually just resigned from Derby County.
That's right.
That was before he went to Brighton.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Well, he was in the broadcasting box, and he famously labelled Tomaszewski as a clown, and of course it was the clown who defied England all evening, save after save. And I tried to show that in my cartoon.
And then Shilton let one go under his body.
Under his body, yes, he did. Norman Hunter made a mistake, and anyway, Shilton should still have saved it. But consequently, one apiece, and with about 30 seconds left, Alf decided to send on Kevin Hector. go on, Kevin, and win it for us. Well, he almost did, but really half a minute isn't long enough for anybody. So out we went.
Yeah.
And we didn't go to the World Cup in 74.
Or 78.
Or 78.
So we move on to 1975. Again, another night with Worthing connotations, because it's a former Worthing publican who had the Far Post, which was the Wigmore, as was down in Wigmore Road there. Malcolm MacDonald, England 5, Cyprus 0.
Yes, we might struggle against some teams, but we could still beat the Minnows, and Cyprus were not really considered great opposition, and MacDonald became one of the few players to score 5 goals for in an England shirt. Yes.
And as can you say, recall who the others are, Bob?
No, I can't.
Oh, no. Nor can I. Answers on a postcard. Right, that's great. And then we'll go. Just get Gazza. Oh, no.
Oh.
Cheer me up.
No, you talk me through that.
No,
come on. This is
a favourite.
You were there,
yes,
weren't you?
Yes, I was there.
Yeah.
This is a favourite of mine. Brighton, Manchester United, 21st of May 1983. What more can you say? The commentator famously shouted at Toole, and Smith must score. We had Gordon as a guest on.
Didn't
mention this.
He's a lovely man.
To be fair, because he's really had it all his life.
Of course.
Because I think it was Peter Jones, it was the radio commentator that actually said, and Smith must score. I don't think it was Motti or Brian Moore.
No,
but sadly, we went back on the Thursday for the replay. Well, I was gonna airbrush over that. It's like, do you know, that's a game I've never watched the highlights of. Never watched the highlights of the FA Cup final replay. Mm. Don't want to.
Yeah, I felt sorry for Smith because he had a decent game and he scored one of the goals, hadn't he?
He opened the scoring, yeah.
I don't know whether it was a bad miss or just a good save. I still don't know, but he's going to have to live with it. What do you say?
Forever.
Right, here we go.
So, we're up almost, I'd now say almost up the present day, but we're not, it's 25 years ago. It doesn't seem... It 25 doesn't. Years,
we're no,
but we're going to England 2, Scotland 0, Euro 96. An amazing Saturday afternoon,
amazing
basking
Saturday.
In the sun. You weren't playing cricket that day, were you?
I was at a wedding, Ian. I was at a wedding reception,
I was
and we were listening to the commentary, and Scotland won a penalty, didn't they? And Seaman saved it, and immediately Gazza went down the other end. Seaman saved from McAllister.
Yeah. Flicked it over Hendry's head and banged it in.
Ah, wonderful piece of...
Absolutely.
Oh, here's Gascoigne. Gascoigne, he can finish it here! Paul Gascoigne! 2-0! Would you believe it?
A genius. Sadly, a tormented genius. But a genius.
A genius indeed, yes.
Yeah, and we wish him well
as he continues
on life's journey. But Gazza was certainly never dull.
No.
It was never dull living with Gazza.
We need another Gazza in the England team now.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I think players like Gazza only come along once in a lifetime. So we'll finish on the ladies, Bob, as we're going through all these games. And the Women's FA Cup Final of 2020, which was Manchester City 3, Everton 1. Talk me through this one, Bob.
Well, I watched it on television like a lot of people, and really very impressed with the way the ladies played. I've got to be careful what I say here, Ian, but really that final put to shame a lot of the men's final, because for excitement, Everton had a very good goalkeeper. She made some amazing saves.
Horton for Lavelle, Weir, really good run by Weir, and so unlucky, but Chloe Kelly with the chance on the follow-up has been brilliantly denied.
What a save that was from McIver, from Kelly. Kelly had already seen a name in lights then as the ball came back to her, but terrific play. You can see McIver and Christensen just throw themselves in front of it.
Eventually City won, deservedly I think, but it was a great advert for women's football, and long live women's football, I think
it's great.
Greenwood again on set piece duty, and once again it's a brilliant one, and this time it has been headed into the back of the net by Sam Mewis, and Manchester City deservedly in front in the Women's FA Cup final.
What a terrific header, wasn't it?
Stanway's made the run. Oh, it's a lovely pass. Stanway's there. And Stanway puts Manchester City back in front in the FA Cup final. Stanway. And here's a chance for the clinching goal. And it has been taken by Janine Becky to make sure that Manchester City do indeed retain the Women's FA Cup. They are worthy winners again this afternoon.
Couple of things before we go, Bob.
Yeah.
When's the book out?
The book is out now.
The book is out now, and it is available from...
It's in the bookshops.
Right. So let's get down there and get those. And Bob, I've got to ask you, how long, on average, would one of these caricature pages take you?
When I started doing match cartoons for newspapers, you went to the match on a Saturday, and it had to be in the paper on the Monday evening. It was the match cartoon was next to the written report of the match.
Mm.
So the time to do it was limited. You had about maybe 8 hours to do the complete thing, which it might seem a long time to you, but for when you've got to work out what you're going to do and which incidents to show, and trying to make them humorous, trying to make them funny. It's not a long time. So they're not works of art,
They are, Bob. But this is a work of art.
The artist looks at them afterwards and says, I could have done better. But because of the time limitations, they had to be instant.
This one jumps out at me on the inside cover, which is your caricature of the England team with the Jules Rimet trophy after Pickles had found it in that bush.
Thank you.
That was a great bit of publicity, wasn't it?
It wasn't a publicity stunt.
But do you have a favourite caricature?
I think that one come pretty near the top. Yes, I enjoyed doing that. I can't think that anything has given me more pleasure than doing that one.
Bob, thank you very much for your time this afternoon, and I look forward to going through the book. Take care.
Thank you, Ian. Thank you very much.
That was One2One with Harty. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.